The pace really affects family life more than anything.
In what way?
Like when we went home for Easter, you can't sit around and talk to mom and dad and brothers and sisters. There's always somebody dropping by the house, you know. Like Easter Sunday, I think it was something like 127 people. Somebody kept count that just came by the house, you know. Well, it wasn't that way before. I could go home and visit, you know, and maybe a couple of friends would come by to say, you know. Or you go fishing, you got four or five boats following you around the lake, you know. If they know you're there.
If somebody makes it big, they'll always be sticking a rib in your side.
Right. The people is what the amazing, the difference they treat you. Like a lot of people in business, when they make it big, they say, oh boy, so-and-so's really changed. Well, it's not them. I know I haven't changed, I don't think. But like when you go back home, the people treat you so different. It really surprised me.
Can you still sit down and play with them and pick with them?
Oh yeah, we have musicals, but there's a couple hundred more people now than there used to be when 15 or 20 of us would get together and play, you know.
For anybody who hasn't ever been down in that part of the country, music is a way of life.
Yeah, it is.
It's a big thing.
This is, like I know the CAMPBELL clan, we used to sit around, that's all we do. We'd have a musical once a week, once a month, once every 6 months, just whenever we could, you know. But usually every night in our immediate family, we'd be sitting around the house playing and singing, you know. Well, there ain't a lot to do back on the farm, you know.
What do you call that music back there?
Well, we play everything. Like I do on the show, we play... Mom and Dad usually do a lot of the old folk things, like the alimony thing they did on the show, In the Pines, stuff that they knew when
Carter
they were...
Carter family type thing?
Yeah, the Carter family type stuff. Oh, even farther back than that, really. Because Grandpa CAMPBELL used to sit around and play things that, you know, I could sit listening for hours and... he'd go back like into the 1800s music. I like music. I don't put music in a bag. I don't categorize music. I judge music like I judge people, by their character, how they are, you know. I don't say this is country, this is pop, or this is bluegrass. It is, in a sense, but there's good and there's bad in all music. And it's a great feeling for me, because, like, Where's the Playground, Susie is a little different record than I've got.
Come and found us here with our toys scattered all around us here. The puzzle that we never found an answer for. Still ask us, darling, just what all the games were for. And here we stand. Stopped us here. It twirled a time or two and then it dropped us here. And still you're not content with something about me. But what merry-go-round can you ride without me to take your hand? If I don't stay around.
I think the caliber of the music now is, it's getting a little better, I think.
You had a chance to go on this Smothers Brothers show. How did that initial getting onto the show come about? Do you remember?
Well, I know Tom. I've known Tommy and Dickie for quite some time from playing guitar on their albums, and sessions. And Tommy, when Gentle on My Mind was a hit, and By the Time I Get to Phoenix was a hit, and I won the Grammys, and Tommy said, you know, I didn't even know you could sing. And he said, can you talk? And I said, well, not too plain, you know, it sounds pretty country sometimes. And he said, well, you know, let's do a summer show. That's really how it all happened.
When you hit Los Angeles, can you sort of chronologically place where you ran across John Hartford?
I actually didn't run into John until after Gentle on My Mind was a hit. I knew of John's work, well, mainly his banjo playing and his writing, but John is really one of the pioneers, I'd say, of busting country music out of its shell of, like you say, writing about a lost love or a dead horse or something, you know, and getting in more with the mind instead of, you know, you broke my heart,
that's
so
right.
I'm going to break
that's
your
right.
jaw routine,
that's
you know.
Right. That's right. And you seem to... When you pick with him, you seem to know.
Oh, I have a lot of admiration for Johnny. To me, he's one of the finest banjo players around. One of the finest songwriters and singers.
Yeah. As if there's no cameras, there's no audience there. That's
right.
Exactly where it's at. Do you do that off cameras? Is that how it stemmed from? As a matter of fact, sitting around during those sessions?
Yeah, that's what it stemmed from. John and I would sit around at rehearsals and say, hey, do you know such and such? And we'd play. This is the way, like, they country or hillbilly musicians are.
It's beautiful.
Or Bob and Bill, my bass player and drummer, they'll sit around and join in at rehearsals. We said, hey, let's try this on the show. And we get more mail about that section of the show than any other part.
Do you really care what people think about you?
Yes, I do, very much. And in fact, they got playing to a crowd, but they say they got 11,000 here tonight, some, you know, one guy mouths off or something. It really bothers me. Because
what about the people that you grew up with, that you played with before? Can you still take the time to...
Oh, yeah. To sit around and chat. In fact, the Lagarde twins just came in.
Yeah.
It's a great stand. They're good entertainers. I'm going to have them on the TV show, I think, this fall. This fall, you'll probably see a lot more unknown people on the show that have a lot of talent. Or I like working with Roy Clark.
Oh, yeah.
Or people like this, people who are talented and... I mean, rather than the regular run of the artists that have the hit record, so to speak, and really don't have that much talent, say.